With that red microphone in front of Jim, he looks like he's pulling off a Trump, and that's his tie. So, so that's how we'll start off episode 256 of the In the Tank podcast. We're going to talk about climate change myths and do a little bit of a stopping socialism segment and maybe a little bit of Joe Biden talk on this episode of the In the Tank podcast. As always, I'm your host, Donald Kendall, and joining me today, I've got Justin Haskins, editorial director here at the Heartland Institute. How are you, good sir?
I'm doing very well, Donald. Great to be with you and with Jim. Very excited for today's show.
Sweet. Your hat is also, you can, I'm sure a bunch of whales have been hurt by anchors. So you're in theme here.
My theme is killing whales. That's been my theme for about a month and a half now, and I'm sticking with it.
Fantastic. Yep. Jim Likely, VP of the Heartland Institute. How are you, good sir?
I'm good. Whale oil certainly is going to make a comeback as a boutique product. So that's why Justin's so interested in killing whales. And remember, everybody, it is Kamala Harris. And anyone who says anything differently is a hater.
That's right.
Yeah. I think it's a racist, Jim. Racist, oh. Not hater. You got
to
be more
even
specific.
That for you to
and
say.
A misogynist. Well, to be fair, the whole time that we were talking about her prior to this recording, I was talking about the wrestler. So
who's
Kamala?
The wrestler?
Yeah, Kamala.
Oh.
Kamala, the Ugandan giant. He died the day before Kamala Harris was picked. In fact, Kamala, the wrestler, his last name is Harris, too.
Exactly. Yeah. Kamala Harris. Weird? So anytime that I pronounce it like that, just know that I'm talking about the wrestler. If I pronounce it Kamala, that I'm talking about the terrible VP choice that Biden made. Jim, you're looking very like you're running for office, man. You got the American pin over there, little lapel pin.
Yep. Yeah, looking good. Got my Reagan stamp over this shoulder over here.
That's right. Yeah. So yeah. I don't know. I mean, maybe you should go up on the debate stage.
Oh, I don't know. I don't ever want to run for anything. I've known too many politicians. I'm already ashamed of being a former journalist. I can't even imagine being a politician.
You can't be possibly worse, though, than the two guys who are going to be debating each other. Can't possibly.
Well, there might be a third if you want Kanye to join in the mix, too.
Oh, boy. Now that I could get behind.
I do want Kanye to join in the mix because it would be hilarious and informative because who knows what kind of crazy conspiracy theory I've never heard before will be entered onto the national stage. But I unfortunately don't think that's going to happen because there's a conspiracy against Kanye.
Yeah, well, maybe Kanye will just have to storm the stage and take the microphone away from him like he did with Taylor Swift on the, way back in the day on the MTV.
He paid for that microphone.
That's right. Oh,
Biden, I'm going to let you finish, but I got to say something first.
That's right. That would be something. Who knows? Hey, it could happen. It could happen. Kanye has definitely done weirder things.
That's the only way that these potential debates could get even more entertaining is if Kanye, they allowed him on stage. So bring it on. Bring Kanye on stage for sure. But yeah, so the debates, I mean, we had a lot of fun at the expense of like the Democratic nomination debates. When they had like 15 people on stage and they're all just ridiculous, right? So we had a lot of fun at the expense of those. So I'm really hoping that there's going to be presidential debates between Trump and Biden. I'm really hoping. I mean, generally speaking, there shouldn't be any reason why we would think there wouldn't be. I mean, obviously there's coronavirus stuff going on. You know, it might be too dangerous to have people, you know, in the audience
talk to each other.
Right. I kind of think that there's, if they were going to be, like Biden is going to be wearing a mask like during it, which opens up the conspiracy of like, is he even talking or are they just have like a pre-recorded thing playing for him?
Well, maybe they could have a random word generator and, you know, they do those deep fakes now where I saw one like with Tom Hanks, it looked just like him and you put words in his mouth and you just, you know, the artificial intelligence can just kind of make it happen. So I don't know. What's scarier, real Joe Biden or AI Joe Biden?
Yeah, well, we'll know whether or not he's on stage or if he's still in his basement, whether or not it's like a deep fake. If it's in his basement, I don't believe it's him. But like another reason to kind of question whether or not these debates are actually going to happen is because there's been like a whole bunch of people coming out just basically trying to convince Biden to not go on stage with Trump and to convince the public to not want Biden to go up on stage with Trump. So I had this one article, and everything we talk about, like always, you can find in the show notes. But this was a Forbes article, and it says some people don't want Biden to debate Trump. Biden isn't one of them. And it goes through and it kind of lists off like a number of people. Former Clinton White House press secretary Joe Lockhart in an op-ed on CNN says, whatever you do, don't debate Trump. Then there was a rash of opinion pieces on major newspapers calling for an end of presidential debates. So the New York Times journalist Elizabeth Dew had an article titled, Let's Scrap the Presidential Debates. There was an article in the Washington Post that was very similar to that. There was an article in the Boston Herald that said, Biden better walk back any offers to debate Trump. And then a lot of, you know, then the last few weeks has been filled with political analysts going on the different shows talking about how Biden shouldn't debate Trump. Bill Kristol was on Twitter talking about how it would be silly for him to do it. And everyone already knows who they're going to vote for anyway. So why should we have a debate? So why is there uncertainty, I guess? Why is there this push for them to not do any debates? Now, some of the reasons that are being proposed out there is because we don't even want to give Trump a we don't even want to give him a platform. You know, everyone already knows who they're voting for. We don't need a debate. Trump is too dishonest. But Jim, I mean, do you buy that? What's the real reason? Why are all these people coming out lockstep about not wanting debates, period?
Because they know the obvious, that Joe Biden can hardly put any, can probably get through a sentence. Now, I can barely get through this one, but I'm not running for president, but he can hardly get through a sentence without stumbling over himself, mixing words up, not making any sense. And if you have him up there on stage three times, and Trump actually wants four times for 90 minutes with just some notes and no handlers and no, hey, let's take that again. I mean, heck, even the introduction, the official announcement over Zoom or whatever between Kamala Harris and Joe Biden announcing that, yeah, I've picked you. He had a script in front of him and he still didn't do it very smoothly. And you have to imagine that might've been the sixth take. This was not a live broadcast. And so real professionals on the Democratic side understand what a potential disaster this can be. Biden has gone up in the polls just the way Hillary did in 2016. The less the people see, the more they approve of him, and the more they see of him, the less they're going to approve of him. The professionals know this. And in fact, the link that you gave us to prepare for this podcast today, Donnie, was from, I believe, Forbes. And the only person in the higher echelons of the Democratic Party who want Joe Biden to debate, apparently, is Joe Biden. Because he's like this, you know, he has this persona of himself as like this tough guy. You know, he had said earlier, you know, I'll take Trump back behind the gymnasium and, you know, and we'll get in a fight and I'll kick his butt and all that stuff. I mean, he's always had this fake tough guy persona. Yeah. And so it's not surprising to me that Joe Biden's like, come on, bring it on. Maybe I could take him on. I say, go for it. This is going to be pretty good. I'd even do this in pay-per-view. I'd pay to see that.
Well, I mean, did you hear Joe Biden talk about his confrontation with Corn Pop? Because he seems like a pretty tough guy.
The threat is real. It was at the public pool, if I remember correctly. It's in 19, you know, 50, whatever. You know, it's tough. It's tough if you're Joe Biden. Because obviously you want everyone in the world to think that mentally you're all there. But you're not. And everybody knows it. Everyone around you knows it. Everyone in the Democratic Party knows it. Everyone in the Republican Party knows it. Everyone who's been paying any attention to you at all knows it. And it must be really frustrating to be Joe Biden and want desperately to be the guy you were 10 years ago, but you're clearly not. It must be very frustrating. And so I'm sure he does want to go out there and just prove to everybody that actually everything is fine. But the people around him and the people who have spent time watching him know that there is a tremendous amount of risk for this. Just tremendous amount of risk. Tremendous. Tremendous. If he goes out there and has an episode like we've seen in the past, like last week, it could be the end of him in literally a 15-second clip. Like that could be the end of Joe Biden. And so I don't I don't know. If you're Joe Biden, it's incredibly frustrating. If you're his handlers, which has got to be like one of the worst jobs in America right now, being a Joe Biden handler, you're terrified. If you're the Democratic Party, you are terrified. If you're the Republicans, you are desperately hoping that you can get this guy in front of a camera as often as possible. It really is an incredible situation that we're in right now. I can't remember anything quite like this, really.
Yeah, you know, so I was obviously the Biden cognitive decline concept has been something that we've talked about. It's been talked about more and more in the public. But I was having a conversation the other day about Reagan. I mean, Jim, you brought him up. You got a stamp over your shoulder about the man. But there was like this idea that's been out there that like during towards the end of Reagan's second term, he started to slip a little bit, right? And it was just like, you know, comparing that to what we might be in for with Biden. So I was curious, and obviously I wasn't aware of what was going on around me I wasn't even alive back when Reagan was president. So I was like, all right, let's pull up like his latest State of the Union, right? So 1988 was his final year. That was the final State of the Union that he did. So I pulled up this clip, and I sent it to you, Andy, just earlier. So if you want to pull it up, that'd be great. But I wanted to kind of compare, like, just see where Reagan was mentally, you know, if these stories are true in his last year. So let's play a little bit of this.
The House and Senate. When we first met here 7 years ago, many of us for the first time, it was with the hope of beginning something new for America. We meet here tonight in this historic chamber to continue that work. If anyone expects just a proud recitation of the accomplishments of my administration, I say let's leave that to history. We're not finished yet.
I mean,
so my message to you tonight is put on your work shoes. We're still on the job. History records the power of the ideas that brought us here those 7 years ago. Ideas like the individual's right to reach as far and as high as his or her talents will permit. The free market as an engine of economic progress.
Yeah, so, I mean,
and
here, let's...
ancient Chinese philosopher.
Let's just stop it right there. So, I mean, Jim, what do you think about that? You're obviously more politically aware back when Reagan was president than Justin or I. So give us your...
By politically aware, he means alive, by the way, just to let you know.
Right.
Well, give us your 2 cents on this.
Well, apparently from listening to that seems to be the State of the Union address right after his reelection in 1984. So that would have been January, I guess, of 1985. At that time, I was 14 years old.
And, I think it was 88, Jim.
It was 88.
Oh, that was 88? Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, that's even better. So then I was 17 then. And I wish I could have voted for Ronald Reagan. I did not have that honor. But, you know, look, you can tell. I think at that point he was 77, 76, something like that.
Really close. 70. We looked it up. It was 70. Was it 8? Almost 78, I think.
Okay. Yeah. And so that's about the age. Actually, I think 78 is the age of Joe Biden if he was to get elected and take the oath of office.
Also right. Man, yeah. You know these ages like the back of your hand.
Well, old people tend to pay attention to those numbers as they get older. So, no, but look, you can tell that Ronald Reagan is in full, in full control and of his capacities here. He was always a great performer, of course. They called him the great communicator, and he used his acting skills. And also he spent years on the road for General Electric giving public policy speeches. And of course, he gave the fantastic speech, A Time for Choosing, for Barry Goldwater in 1964. And so the man was an absolute professional speaker, maybe the best orator as president that we've ever had. But you can tell that he is very much in control of his faculties. He's not really losing a step, certainly not to the level Joe Biden is, who with scripts still can't get through things.
Well, yeah.
And it's important to note that, you know, there was no evidence, medical evidence that And none of his doctors had said that Ronald Reagan, even after he had left office and had passed away, that there were any signs of any kind of dementia or Alzheimer's while he was in power as president of the United States. Of course, he tragically did suffer from Alzheimer's disease and declined and passed away. But he left us with that great letter that he wrote to the American people as he was approaching the sunset of his life. That actually my wife's uncle Nils is a docent at the Reagan Library in Simi Valley, California, and I was able to see and read that letter, and it's really, really touching. And but it's obvious that Ronald Reagan, while getting older, and everybody slows down a little bit when they get older, he was 100% on point and was not showing any signs of losing any of his mental acuity.
Yeah, so when I pulled that clip up, obviously we won't play the length of it or anything like that, but as you continue on, like, it's really good. It's a really good speech. He had he cites a lot of quotes, like really good quotes, and he doesn't seem to just be reading off of any notes right in front of him or anything like that. So I feel free to check that out. I'll put that in the show notes as well, but it's a really good speech, but I want to compare it. So this is Reagan was at his, you know, last year before leaving office. Let's compare that to this clip of Joe Biden before he even takes office. So play the one, like the CNN one, Andy. Or no, it wasn't CNN, but it's like the third clip I sent you.
I think we have to rethink how we define what constitutes a successful economy. They see workers as just a means to an end. Not the end in themselves. The same is happening in big hospital systems for the United Food and Commercial Workers in Boston. Medical research to conquer devastating diseases like cancer. The UAW took incredible cuts in their future. The country wasn't built by Wall Street bankers, CEOs, and hedge fund managers.
All right, stop it there.
It was built by you.
So play the other one too, because that's just like a compilation of some of his stumbles. But this other one, I think, is a little bit more revealing of just like, I think he's a little past his
prime. Mr. Vice President, your opponent in this election, President Trump, has made your mental state a campaign topic. And when asked in June if you'd been tested for cognitive decline, you've responded that you're constantly tested in effect because you're in situations like this on the campaign trail. But please clarify specifically, have you taken a cognitive
test? No, I haven't taken a test. Why the hell would I take a test? Come on, man. That's like saying you, before you got in this program, if you take a test where you're taking cocaine or not, what do you think, huh? Are you a junkie?
What do you say to President Trump, who brags about his test and makes your mental state an issue for voters?
I shouldn't say it. I'm going to say something I probably shouldn't say. Anyway, I am very willing to let the American public judge my physical and mental fitness, and to make a judgment about who I am.
Yeah, so let's make a judgment. I mean, it's really hard for me to watch these clips. My knee-jerk reaction is to kind of laugh at the expense of Joe Biden, but we've all had loved ones that have suffered through what we think might be happening with this man. But I don't know, like, compare those two. Like, if there's people that are honestly saying that Reagan was kind of losing a step, and then they say, like, yeah, but we should elect this guy. How does that work, Justin?
I don't know. I mean, other than the fact that the left doesn't care about these rules that they create for themselves, for the right. Okay. They create these rules for the right. They don't care. They don't follow these rules. These are the same people that, you know, elect Bill Clinton, who supposedly, who may very likely have raped women, who sexually assaulted women, who was accused of all kinds of horrible things, serially cheated on his wife, including in the Oval Office with an intern. By today's standards, the left would call that rape. Just even though it was consensual sexual activity in the Oval Office, they would call that rape by today's standards. Oh, sure. Many people on the left, because of the power dynamic and everything else.
No doubt.
So they look the other way on that. And then when you had ridiculous accusations against people on the right, like Judge Kavanaugh, for example, where there was essentially zero evidence except someone telling a story that the details weren't even 100% accurate decades later, they all lined right up and believed her. I mean, Kamala Harris, how do we pronounce her name?
Kamala.
What is it? Kamala. All right. Kamala Harris. Kamala Harris. She, when asked during the campaign prior to being named Joe Biden's vice president, presidential running mate, she was asked whether she believed the women who were accusing Joe Biden of all of this, of a sexual assault, of rape, etc. And she said, yes, she believed them. She believed them. And so now she's on the ticket with someone who she said before she thinks is guilty of rape. So these people, when it comes to, you know, mental acuity and age and stuff like that, I mean, if they're willing to look the other way and all this other stuff, then yeah, of course they're willing to look the other way on this. But the thing that I think is most interesting about this is that the narrative about Ronald Reagan in the 1980s, that he was old and he was slipping and all of that stuff, he left office, as Jim mentioned earlier, he left office at the same age that Joe Biden is entering office with signs that he is slipping. So just think about that. It does. There's no way this guy's going to be in his 80s soon. Okay. And he's already clearly slipping. The idea that this guy is capable of serving even, I think, 4 years, but 8 years is inconceivable. He's openly saying he's not even going to serve 8 years. I mean, that's how ridiculous this whole thing is. So the left is looking the other way because it serves their purpose. Their purpose, of course, is to get rid of Donald Trump, but also they know that Joe Biden is just going to do whatever they want anyway. He's already proven that. And the choice of Kamala Harris is a great example of that. I mean, she's a far left-wing person. The Democratic Party did not want her. They rejected her. And she ended up being the vice presidential nominee anyway, even though she had been roundly rejected by the entire Democratic Party, essentially. Yeah. Didn't even make it to Iowa, resigned before we even got to 2020, or resigned the campaign. And now she's literally extremely close to being president of the United States of America. I mean, she's got a really good shot. You could argue, depending on how you think about Donald Trump, you could argue she's got a better chance of being president in 2 years than Donald Trump does. So, I mean, that's how bad it is. All right. It's real bad. And they don't care because that's ultimately what they want anyway. They never wanted Joe Biden. They want a far left-wing person. And if this is how they have to get it, then this is how they have to get it.
Yeah, so Jim, I guess my final question on all of this is, will the debates happen? Like, if you had to put your little Nostradamus hat on, are they going to happen?
Yes, they are going to happen. I think all three debates are going to happen. The first one's supposed to be in Cleveland, Ohio, I think, in about a month, actually. So I'm actually looking forward to it. But yes, they will happen.
They have to happen, because if they don't happen, he's going to lose anyway. So he has to do the debates or else he'll lose. Biden will lose if he doesn't do the debates.
We can't pick a president of the United States and have the two opponents never meet and speak about their policies against each other. It's just inconceivable. It cannot happen.
He has to do it. We talked about this earlier, Donnie, and we haven't brought it up yet, but the schedule of the debates themselves is actually really interesting. And I think really hurts Joe Biden, because it seems like the more Joe Biden talks, the more often you see him, the more tired he gets, the more these kinds of things slip in, that we see him falling apart, essentially, the longer he goes on. Debates are very long, very intense, very tiring. And the way they built the debate schedule this time around is that essentially, there are three presidential debates in 4 weeks, three in 4 weeks. And the separate, that week between them, the two week gap there is a vice presidential debate. So you're literally, America is going to have four debates in 4 weeks, essentially. And the debates are, one's in Cleveland, Ohio. That's in September. Then you have September 29th. Then you have Miami, Florida, 2 weeks later on October 15th. And then 1 week after that, Nashville, Tennessee. So he's going to be traveling. These guys are going to be traveling all over the country. Big, long debates, lots of pressure right before the election. Literally the fate of the free world hangs on these debates, and all the money, everything Democrats have put into this, it all rests on Joe Biden somehow managing to get through these three, 9 hours of talking without looking like he does when he's on the air for 5 minutes. I mean, this is a really dangerous time for Democrats. And so the debate schedule does not help, not at all.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm very curious. I mean, obviously we get a lot of entertainment from these debates, and I'm sure we'll be covering them pretty well on this podcast. But I'm curious to see what Joe Biden has to even say, you know, because he seemed to be elected as the nominee, like moderate, you know, as opposed to Bernie Sanders, who's more of the radical. But it seems like all the stuff that we've been covering regarding Biden seems to suggest that he's going way much, much further to the left. So I really don't know. Jim, I don't know. What do you think? Is he going to be moderate or is he going to be radical?
Be moderate. He just picked the most one of the most radical leftist senators in the United States Senate. I think the only senator with a voting record among Democrats. We have to throw out Bernie Sanders because he's a quote unquote independent, which is ridiculous. But the only senator with a far left with a voting record farther to the left than Kamala Harris was Elizabeth Warren. So, you know, she's way, way to the left. Biden has this reputation of being a moderate, of being down the middle. And I think that, you know, you can make that argument over the years. It has been that way. But look, he was vice president to a very leftist president in Barack Obama. He endorsed, you know, many leftist policies while he was vice president over the years. As a senator, maybe you could say he was down the middle. And of course, gosh, I mean, he started his Senate career when he was 29 years old. He had to wait after the election until his 30th birthday to actually be old enough to be sworn in as a United States senator. That's how long he's been in Washington, D.C. And back in the day, well, heck, Kamala Harris criticized him for working with segregationist Dixiecrats and Democrats. That's how long he's been in the Senate. And so, you know, so he was down the middle, or you could say moderate, over time in the 80s, for instance, but not anymore. And in fact, the left, the squad, and other leftists in the House of Representatives are openly admitting that they see Joe Biden as a vessel into which they will pour their hard leftist agenda. I think we have a clip of this, Andy, but Representative Pramila Jayapal, she was on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah on Comedy Central a few weeks back, and she talked openly about how she was going to be that the left has pushed Biden and they will continue to, and they just cannot wait to get him into the White House so that they can use him as the agent of our destruction, maybe in Ghostbusters terms. They have that's how they see Joe Biden working out if he's elected president. Do you have that clip, Andy?
President Biden. I will be right there with him. I will be doing everything I can to support and get everyone to turn out for Joe Biden. And I will be pushing him. I will, you know, as soon as we get him in the White House, and even before with these task forces that we had, we were able to significantly push Joe Biden to do things that he hadn't signed on to before. So he is movable. He is listening. And he does understand that we need turnout from young people, from folks of color. And I'm going to do everything I can to help get him elected. And then I'm going to be right out front, making sure that we continue to push for the policies that we need as a country.
First off, they're referring to him like he's a coma patient. He is moving. He's listening, pretty sure of it. You can see him nodding his head.
Yeah, he wiggled his finger the other day.
How dare you?
Yeah. But look, this is the message that Donald Trump wants. I mean, and I think the left is so confident. I think they're delusional on this, but they really do think that with our cities on fire, with protests all over the place, they think that the wind is at their back and that the ship of state is going to be going to the left. And all they have to, and so now they can say it. They can say it out loud. Donald Trump, when these debates happen, and I know he's not really known for his discipline and his message discipline, but he should be telling the American people, especially Democrats and independent voters, that a vote for Joe Biden is not a vote for the Joe Biden of 1995. It is a vote for the hard left squad of the House of Representatives who are going to be taking over basically the government from Joe Biden, and it's going to be run by hard leftists. And this is what you're voting for. The Democratic Party that you think you know, it doesn't exist anymore, certainly not in this election. If Trump doesn't hammer on that idea because it happens to be the truth and it's important to share it, you know, then he will be in big trouble. And this is been obvious to people paying attention, and now they're even saying it on Comedy Central, hoping to get the kids out to actually vote for that agenda.
Yeah.
Well, and just real quick, I mean, Kamala Harris is, you know, if you need any proof at all, if you have a friend or a neighbor or someone who says, oh, no, I've read in the New York Times that she's actually a, you know, common sense, middle of the road liberal or whatever, which I've actually heard liberals presenting her this way. In fact, I even heard conservatives on Fox and Friends the other day refer to her as sort of a, she's just, you know, your regular liberal. If there's any question whatsoever, then I think you need to look at the Green New Deal. We've talked about the Green New Deal a million times. It's obviously socialism. We don't need to get into the details of it. But the reality is Kamala Harris not only supported Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez's Green New Deal, she was a co-sponsor of it in the Senate, a co-sponsor along with Bernie Sanders and a bunch of other crazies. So what more do you need? I mean, free healthcare, she supports that. Free college, she supports that. Federal jobs guarantee, she supports that. A new system of public-owned banks, she supports that. Destroying the fossil fuel industry, she supports that. I mean, there is very few things, really, that Bernie Sanders supports that Kamala Harris has not openly supported within the past couple of years as well. So she is pretty close to Bernie Sanders level. I would say she's really in line with, say, Elizabeth Warren, maybe a touch less socialistic than Elizabeth Warren, but I mean that's essentially where she's at. So this is literally the worst thing Joe Biden could have done is pick someone that makes it look like he's moved as far to the left as those of us who have watched him really closely know that he's moved that far. I mean, it's a terrible pick.
This is the new age, Justin. I mean, if you think that this is just a flash in the pan, apparently you're not reading Teen Vogue. So this is my transition to the
stuff. I'm not reading Teen Vogue.
So this article record. Became, somebody sent it to me, but yeah, Teen Vogue.
Was it a teen?
No. Eviction crisis is coming. We need to treat housing as a right. Okay. So Teen Vogue's not one of the magazines that I subscribe to. I don't read it too constantly. So I had to Google it. Teen Vogue. So Teen Vogue says the latest on fashion, beauty, celebrity style, entertainment, teen issues, videos, and more. So I guess the social Marxism and anti-capitalism doctrine fits under the and more category. So just an FYI. But yeah, this article, you know, you can find it on Teen Vogue right next to BTS and TXT are both dropping new albums before 2020 is over. And Kia Gerber and Kara something showed off their matching tattoos. So right next to that, you get a nice dosage of modern Marxism. So the first paragraph of this, I just kind of want to go through and dissect this and discuss it. But the first paragraph is just really revealing in its own. So it starts off, it says, it's been 4 months since the onslaught of the coronavirus pandemic highlighted the failures of capitalism and the incompetence of the United States government. So it's just that, just the first sentence. We don't even say the first paragraph, the first sentence. The coronavirus pandemic has highlighted the failures of capitalism. Really? Was it capitalism that shut down capitalism? Or was it the government that did that? I don't remember. You have to refresh my memory. And the incompetence of the United States government. So right in the first sentence, they talk about the incompetence of the United States government. But as you go through this article and just think of the implications of getting rid of private property, which is essentially the main point of this article, and to treat housing as a right, who's in charge of that housing then? Who gets to decide who gets what and how that housing is distributed around? Oh, it's the government, the one that was so incompetent that they couldn't even handle the coronavirus. So it's just like, I don't know. Just thoughts off the top of your head, Jim, before I further go into this article.
Well, yeah. First of all, people watching this podcast on YouTube will see that there was an automatic pop-up that came as Andy was scrolling through there, and it said, "Politics, stay informed, the Teen Vogue way." Oh, my God. I mean, I know it's Teen Vogue, but is it actually written by children? The second paragraph says this. I'm going to go through it, but let me do it. It says Congress did not rise to the occasion, providing or even seriously considering necessary transformational policies like universal basic income, universal health care, rent supervision,
Suspension.
I'm sorry, rent suspension or debt forgiveness. Instead, they gave us crumbs through a one-time payment of $1,200 and $600 extra in unemployment. Now, you have to be a child not to understand that you actually think Congress is going to do all of that in like a matter of weeks, and the president's going to sign it, and it's going to become law, and then these things are going, these national transformational policies. Oh my gosh, they didn't get it done in 20 minutes. You know, can you believe how broken our system is?
Yeah,
I mean, it's unbelievable. But this whole idea, you know, the entire thing is Dan Crawford. Is that the name of his Crenshaw? Dan Crenshaw, the congressman from Texas.
Yeah.
He called this Marxist propaganda for teens, and that's exactly right. The idea that anybody, first of all, a 14-year-old, you're not paying rent. You might want to take this up with your mom. Maybe when you're 20 and still living with mom, they might charge you rent, but that's something you should handle as a family, right? But you know, this is Marxist propaganda for teens, and as silly as it is, the idea that young people are getting their political news from Teen Vogue, it's easy to laugh at. But it's not wrong. It's not false. This is actually being pushed to children to embrace Marxist doctrine that has been a disaster all throughout human history.
Yeah, I can't imagine that next to the 10 planners that'll help you achieve your economic goals article is something highlighting the value of capitalism or anything like that. I'm sure that it's all just kind of tied to talking about the squad and different Marxist ideas. The third paragraph is where it really gets to the point of the article. It says, while we are working to abolish the police, we must also work to dismantle what the police were put here to protect, property. So, I mean, wait a second. Let's put pause on that, right? The goal is to abolish the police? I thought it was just defunding the police. And I thought defunding the police was just like a radical way of saying that we wanted to like diversify the organizations that were taking... to deal with the problems in society. But no, it's abolishing the police apparently in Teen Vogue. So yeah, I guess that's the case. But yeah, getting rid of property. So it's a dismissal of property rights. Since the pandemic didn't create this housing crisis, but it did further expose the cruelty of payment-based housing. So, I mean, it's true. Again, the pandemic didn't create this housing crisis. The government shutting down the economy did. So it's just, and then it kind of goes through and it starts rambling at certain points and talks about the Constitution was just this thing created by old rich white men, goes on a tangent about colonizers giving Native Americans smallpox and throws a couple of jabs at Trump along the way. But then it ends with the best sentence of the whole thing that says, we need a housing movement based on the rejection of the construct that any one person should own this earth's land. So, Justin, I mean, you and I have kind of went through the whole Communist Manifesto. And one thing that I think we agree on is that, like, communist socialists or any real just rabble-rousers do a really good job at, like, pointing out what the perceived problems in society are, but are just terrible at explaining how to fix those problems in any real meaningful way. So what are your thoughts on all this?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. There's so much that we could talk about. First of all, I think it's important to point out that this person who's writing this article is pretty clearly a communist, not a liberal, not a progressive, not a socialist, but like an actual Marxist communist. Her line about abolishing private property is sort of the dead giveaway. Whenever you hear people talking about abolishing private property, that means they're not socialists, but they're actually communists.
Yeah.
In Communist Manifesto, Karl Marx said, the theory of communists may be summed up in one single sentence, abolition of private property. Which almost sounds exactly identical to the line that she has in this article, which is pretty incredible. The one positive takeaway from this, I think, is that it gets so laughably, it's so laughably, you know, specific and Marxist and in the weeds and stuff that there's no way that a 14-year-old, you know, girl looking for lipstick advice is going to be like, continuing to read through this 2,500 word treatise on Marxism and the abolition of private property. Like, that's probably not going to happen. I think she overplayed her hand. However, it is pretty terrifying that Teen Vogue made a decision to, I looked this writer up. She's not just someone who wrote this one-off thing. She's a columnist for Teen Vogue. She writes a column for these people. So every week or whatever, the teens reading Teen Vogue get to hear about this, you know, from this Marxist spewing Marxist trash that's totally illogical. And this is the thing, Donnie, you and I and Jim, you know, we can all laugh about, oh, well, look at these ridiculous things. At one point, you read the quote earlier, she referred to the $600 unemployment bonus as a crumb. A crumb. We were paying people $600 extra a week not to work. We were paying the vast majority of people who got that were getting more money to stay home than they were earning while they were working. And she says that's a crumb. That's not even good enough for her. Think about how insane that is, right? So, I mean, the idea that you have a person like this regularly providing this kind of information and that Teen Vogue is made an executive decision at the top to go out and hire a Marxist to regularly talk to teenagers about why this is all, you know, a good thing, why we need to have Marxism and the whole system is racist and unfair and all of that. That is pretty terrifying because obviously it's not helping them sell copies of Teen Vogue. Why would you do this? The only reason you would bring someone like this in is to indoctrinate children with Marxist ideology. There's literally no other reason. It's not like you could make the case that, well, you know, we already have all these Marxists here that, you know, really care about, you know, hearing about, you know, some new album that just came out and also Marxism. And so we have to give them what they want. No, they went out and made an executive decision to cram this stuff down kids' throats. And that's really disturbing. And I think that's the worst part of all of this. Who is running Teen Vogue and why are they doing this? I mean, I think is actually becoming a really important question because this is not the first time that Teen Vogue has done something like this before.
Yeah. I mean, this is
stop the hammering out there. Who's got a hammer?
This goes way beyond.
And who's
beyond
got the sickle with the hammer?
Yeah. Right. Nice. Nice. This goes way beyond like them calling for like universal healthcare or something like that. Right? This goes way beyond just any individual program. We need more renewable energies. This is trying to chip away at property rights, which is like a foundational thing of a free society. In fact, Timothy and Christina Sandifer, who I think we actually had Christina on the show at one point.
We had them both present at a Heartland event about a year ago. Yep.
Was it on their book, Cornerstone of Liberty, Property Rights in 21st Century America?
That's the one.
So yeah, I found their book here and I was kind of just looking for like a good piece that would really show just like how crucial property rights are. So it says here, private property holds together a free society. It enables free societies to create wealth and enables minorities to defend themselves against prejudiced majorities. And it allows people to realize their values in physical form, to live the way they believe, to express themselves and to enjoy the fruits of their labor. It is truly the cornerstone of liberty. And I mean, I think that this is just like, you can't separate this. You can't have a free society without property rights.
Right.
Like when you own your own land, when you own your own house, you're basically the king of that area for the most part. Obviously, there's exceptions there. But the idea that we're just going to take all of that away and put it in the hands of the government, something that she admits is so inept that it can't even respond to the coronavirus. Like it's just like it blows my mind. Like how can you actually put that on paper and think that you're making like consistent logical sense? It blows my mind.
Well, Justin, when was the Communist Manifesto? Was that 150 years ago? Is it 170 now? Yeah, as I'm getting
mid 1800s.
Yeah, I mean, this is not a new idea. This is the oldest idea there is, and that is to take from others by force. And give to whoever you think is more worthy than that person. It's all ruling by force. But you know, private property ownership and individual liberty are inexorably linked. You can't if you don't have the right to keep what you've earned. If the government can just take it away from you arbitrarily and give it to somebody else, you don't have any rights at all. The founding fathers, as they were writing the Constitution, understood that really property rights underpins everything. All of the rights, because if you don't have the right to keep what you've earned, you don't have any rights at all. If the government can take away what you have produced by your own labor, then that is tyranny. It's the definition of tyranny. But I would like to ask this writer, okay, all right, you don't like property rights. Hey, that's a pretty nice looking iPhone. Let me take that and give that to somebody else. This writer, she works for Teen Vogue. I presume she has a pretty nice wardrobe. I think we should take that. That's too much clothes. She doesn't need that. Let's give those to the homeless people on Skid Row in Los Angeles where she lives, because they probably need it more. You know, this is where this goes. I mean, it was Ted Cruz that actually tweeted on this. It was actually a pretty big thing on Twitter a few days ago. But Ted Cruz said, "Hey, who owns Teen Vogue?" And then other people commenting underneath that were like, you know, you're right. I need some office space property, so I'm just going to go to the Teen Vogue office in New York City, and I'll just take it because property rights shouldn't be a value for anybody. So I'm going to take that. These leftists, you might think that these leftists, these radical Marxists who haven't had a new idea in 150 years, other than creative ways to cause misery and destruction and death, you might think that they think it won't apply to them. If this writer thinks that when the Marxist revolution happens in this country, when the freest, most prosperous society in human history is torn down and replaced with Marxist ideology, that she is going to be spared the misery. She has another thing coming. That's what all the revolutionaries thought. The Bolshevik Revolution in Russia, you would think, based on propaganda, that it was some kind of bottom-up, revolution of the workers against the oppressive czar. It was a revolution by the elite to create a new elite. This is the way it always has been. And, you know, we've tried these experiments with public property in lieu of private property rights, even in the United States. The public housing experiments, you know, Cabrini Green here in Chicago and other places, they became places of misery and death and drugs. And, you know, we reformed those things, and we have other public housing ways to help people get housing when they can't afford it. But then you take it to the extreme in a Marxist society, the collective, you know, if there's no home, if there's no property ownership, because it is immoral for a human being to think I own this land, what do you think happens to agriculture in this country? The farms in the United States that feed us very well and the world are all on private property. You know, you guys doing the Stopping Socialism stuff know this very well, but there were two very big disasters in collective farming and in eliminating the private ownership of land and letting people farm and sell their products and sell the fruits of their labor. And it was in Ukraine, in the Soviet Union, in 1932, 1933, called the Holodomor, that killed 10 million Ukrainians, starved them to death in a matter of just a little over a year. And then, of course, the Great Leap Forward in China in the late 50s and early 60s. That killed about 50 million people. So Marxist ideology isn't just wrong and stupid and silly. It's deadly. It's deadly on a massive scale. And the fact that, you know, this is Teen Vogue, I know it's, you know, we shouldn't take it seriously, but this kind of messaging is getting through to teenagers. Hopefully they would learn, they get a little smarter when they get to maybe 16 instead of 14.
Yeah, Justin, I'm going to give you the last words on this segment, but one of my favorite takes on this. So the author of this article tweeted, "If my rent money is paying for my landlord's mortgage, shouldn't I be part owner?" And my favorite response to that I saw was like, "Oh yeah, I remember the time that I ate a Big Mac and became part owner of McDonald's."
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. You know, I think when it comes to the property ownership thing, this is going to sound weird, but I really do think that this is true. I think that for my generation and slightly younger and probably slightly older, I think that the biggest reason why you do have some of these millennials warming up to this idea of what, you know, we just, you can't own nature, you can't own the planet, you can't have private property, this is all so evil. I blame Pocahontas. That movie is full of that kind of ideology.
Do you blame Elizabeth Warren or the Disney?
No, not Elizabeth. I mean, I blame her too, but I'm talking about the real Pocahontas. Okay. And by real, I mean the cartoon version, which is not based on reality at all. That version of Pocahontas, which it's this Native American, you know, teaching the stupid white man that his ways are wrong and that if we all just lived in collective harmony, everything would be wonderful, and that white people ruined everything. Like, that's basically the moral of much of that story, is essentially the way it works out. And the male hero of the story only becomes a hero once he realizes that the Native Americans are actually right about everything and that he should, you know, be on their side, right? But in addition to just being ridiculous revisionist history, I think it's important for people to understand that that when you look at Native American history, yeah, they didn't necessarily all have private property ownership and all of this stuff. They were also extremely hierarchical societies. You didn't have everyone had equal things. That's not true. They were at war with each other constantly all over the place. They brutalized each other. They committed horrible human rights violations in ways that you can't even begin to imagine in today's standards, ritually sacrificing innocent people. They had slavery. They mass murdered each other all over the place. They committed infanticide in many places. Obviously, it changed from tribe to tribe, but that's really the truth about most Native Americans. And that was their utopian, that's close to the utopian world that these people want as you could possibly get. You know, they didn't have the same kind of systems that we have today. We didn't have white people who are obviously terrible. We didn't have private property ownership in a traditional sense. And yet they were mass murdering each other and committing infanticide and sacrificing people to the gods and all this other nonsense. So the idea that this is that you have this just if we just get rid of private property, all of our problems would be solved is totally ridiculous and historically inaccurate. And that's proof of it right there.
Oh, yeah. No, it'd be an absolute disaster, like biblical proportions. But we have about 10 minutes left, so I want to get to one more topic here. So this is kind of a climate change myth. So as you might not be aware, listeners of this, and you should be, the Heartland Institute has a new website called Climate at a Glance. It's actually been around for a few months. I don't know. Time goes by way too quick nowadays. But the website basically boils down climate topics into like 1 to 2 page like primers that are just focused on like the different arguments that are going on out there about climate change. So it's a really good website. You can get a lot of good information just really quick without having to read through 30,000 words or some giant textbook like the one sitting behind Jim over there. But they just released a new one called Livestock and Methane that I kind of wanted to get to. I wanted to talk about this a little bit. But to tee this up, I think Kamala Harris might be the perfect person to tee this up. So I don't know if you guys remember, surely Jim and Justin do, but I'm talking more to the audience here. But almost a year ago at this point, CNN did a 7-hour-long climate crisis town hall with all of the Democratic presidential candidates. We dedicated an entire episode to this because it was a complete disaster on their part. It was hilarious. Each candidate basically tried to outdo each other on how authoritarian they could be when it comes to trying to solve the climate crisis. Pete Buttigieg called us sinners for releasing CO2. Bernie Sanders bordered on calling for population control. Elizabeth Warren sounded sane by comparison by talking about how we were too wrapped up in these debates about light bulbs. But one of my favorite clips was when Kamala Harris discussed Americans' diet. So, Andy, if you have that clip, just go ahead and start playing that.
But now more questions for some.
No, go ahead. It's fine. You could play it.
But now more questions for Senator Kamala Harris. So let's go straight to an audience question. Now, Carolyn Corsant is a lawyer from New York, Senator. She has a question about the impact of certain foods on the environment. Just to give some context here, the United Nations says that livestock cattle, contribute 14.5% of all human-produced greenhouse gases, which is an incredible number. Carolyn, go ahead with your question.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Climate change has been linked to agriculture and the overconsumption of red meat and also the overproduction of crops. Certain countries have changed their dietary guidelines to reduce the consumption of red meat in light of the impact of the climate change.
Yeah.
If elected, will you be supporting change in dietary guidelines? And then how will you plan on implementing the changes so that people effectively change their diets?
Yeah, I mean, it's and thank you, Carol, for your work and the question. I think of the point that you're raising in a broader context, which is that as a nation, we actually have to have a real priority at the highest level of government around what we eat and in terms of healthy eating, because we have a problem in America. And we can talk about all that we are now, the subject of this conversation. We can talk about the amount of sugar in everything. We could talk about soda. We could go on and on. So the answer is yes. But I'll also say this. The balance that we have to strike here, frankly, is about what government can and should do around creating incentives and then banning certain behaviors. I mean, just to be very honest with you, I love cheeseburgers from time to time, right? I mean, I just do. But there has to be also what we do in terms of creating incentives that we will eat in a healthy way, that we will encourage moderation, and that we will be educated about the effect of our eating habits on our environment. And we have to do a much better job of that. And the government has to do a much better job of that.
So, I mean, I'm just saying, you love cheeseburgers. I mean, we all do. I don't know whether
you know, from time to
try
time,
the Beyond Burger.
Oh,
cheese. Right?
I have to admit
it's not quite the same.
They're so relatable, guys.
All right, go ahead and stop the clip there.
I mean, changing the dietary.
It really seemed at one point that she was just like waiting to be cut off so she didn't actually have to directly say that she wants to limit our meat consumption. But like, she says a whole bunch of things during that that is just that it's just overboard.
I actually think we stopped it right before she is asked directly, will you add this to the dietary guidelines?
Okay.
I think she says yes right after that.
Yeah. No doubt. I think she says, of course, actually, which is just crazy that, like, you know, because of climate change, we're going to change the dietary guidelines that are set by like the government health agencies. It's just like, okay, I thought this had to do with health and like a balanced diet, but no, it has to do with politics. So
no, it's not about politics, it's about saving the planet, Donald. If we've learned anything from the past 50 years, it's that if we don't all sacrifice something that we love dearly,
well,
the planet will explode into a fiery hell and we'll all die. If we haven't learned that, then what have we learned?
So this climate at a glance thing should ease your mind a little bit, Justin, because it shows that American ranchers and meat consumption have virtually no impact on overall greenhouse gas emissions or climate. EPA reports cattle and beef accounts for just 2% of U.S. greenhouse gas emissions. EPA reports all livestock account for less than 4% of U.S. greenhouse gas emissions. By contrast, crop production accounts for more greenhouse gas emissions than total livestock production. So there goes into a little bit more detail. There's a short summary that kind of explains all of this. You can find it on the website there. Obviously, everything I talk about will be linked in the show notes, as I said, all of the time. But, you know, there's other stuff, too. Because Justin and I, we've looked into this when we were doing some writing on climate change stuff. And I was kind of blown away to find out that, like, rice paddies – like growing rice actually releases more methane gas than livestock. So what are we going to change to? If we can't eat meat, if she's going to say, you know, we can't eat as many hamburgers as we do as Americans, we have to like switch to a more rice diet. Oh, well, there's just going to be more methane gas emissions from that. So
only one solution. We have to stop eating, Donald.
Just period.
We just got to stop. We got to stop to save the planet. If we're not willing to sacrifice ourselves to save ourselves, then actually, yeah, that doesn't make any sense, does it?
Jim, you...
We die either way, so... We're dead either way, so I guess eat up, guys. It's fine.
Jim, I really like this climate at a glance concept, climateataglance.com. So I'll let you kind of speak to it and have the final word on this subject.
Well, yeah, Climate at a Glance, as you mentioned, it's kind of shepherded by Anthony Watts, who's one of the most prominent popular skeptics of human caused climate change in the world. What's up with that? WATTS up with that is one of the most read climate websites in the world and has been for quite some time. So he is the one who's gathering this information, and so there's a lot of complicated. There's actually a lot of subtopics, obviously, when it comes to climate. You know, what is livestock and agriculture and methane? What effect does that actually have on the climate? So you can it's in it's intended to be a place where you can quickly get information to counter, well, like that lawyer in that climate town hall with CNN who was giving bad information. So it can be a great resource for you. We update it several times a week, and we'll continue to build on it. And you'll be able to search through there and see if there's any aspect of the climate debate that you need to brush up on. For Thanksgiving's coming up in a few months, and we're going to be berated by our by our family if you're not, you know, woke enough on climate. So you might want to use that as a resource to help you get armed up intellectually. But you know, just I'll put a little bow on this whole Kamala Harris thing and the climate stuff, is that she is a hard leftist. She's actually, just like Biden, she's allowing herself to be pushed to the left. She'll basically say, yeah, I agree to anything. The lawyer said, you know, will you redo the federal guidelines on nutrition to have it so that we eat less red meat? And she says, well, yes, of course. But she likes a cheeseburger from time to time. Mm-hmm. And so, again, you know, the people at the top get to basically do whatever they want. And the rest of us plebs and serfs will just have to obey. Right now they are federal guidelines, and the federal guideline nutrition guidelines change, you know, pretty frequently. We've pretty much flipped the entire, when I was a kid, you were told, you know, eat a lot more carbs. Now that's completely different. Things keep changing. And this idea that the government has the final say and the correct say on what you should eat and how much you should eat is absurd, because the government is largely incompetent. But when these leftists take over our government, Joe Biden is elected and Kamala Harris is there, Kamala Harris is vice president, these guidelines will then be mandates. They will implement policy and through the executive branch and through legislation that will take away our freedom to choose what kind of food we want to grow, what kind of food we want to eat, and in what volume we would like to eat them. Look, I could lose some weight. I could use a few fewer cheeseburgers a week than I currently eat, but that is my choice and in a free country, the government should have no say, and the vice president, potential vice president of the United States, should have no say on how much I eat, what I eat, and what I do with my life. And that's a complete different mindset. The people in that audience just love bossing you around. I don't.
No, they're going to have, if the Teen Vogue people have their way, the government's going to tell you exactly how you're going to live and probably what you're going to eat. So let's enjoy that if it comes our way.
That's not true, Donald. That's false.
Why is that? What?
Well, because there won't be any property. We'll all just be living in a Mad Max hellscape anyway. So
that's cool.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's right, because of climate change. All right, that's all the time we have for today. We're going to leave it there. Audience, if you like our show, please subscribe. Write a review for us on iTunes. That would be greatly appreciated. You can find our show every Friday, new episode. If you'd like, you can follow us on Twitter at In The Tank Pod, socialist Twitter, as I like to call it. If you'd like to send us a comment, suggestion, question, feel free to email us at inthetankpodcast@gmail.com. Justin, where can the fine people find you?
At Justin T. Haskins on Facebook and Twitter. Look for the big, beautiful blue check mark. Still there, not banned yet, folks. So
it's a good point. It's a good point. And Jim, same question. Where can the fine people find you?
At Jay Lakely on Twitter, at Heartland Inst on Twitter, heartland.org, climateataglance.org. Check out all of our stuff.
Yeah, no doubt. All right. Thank you all for tuning in. We'll talk to you next week.
And that I'm going to beat Joe Biden.